Everyone, please turn off all cell phones and electronic devices and rise for a moment of silence and pledge of flag. A roll call.
Coniston.
Here.
Turnbull.
Here.
Amo.
Here.
Nagustakis.
Present.
Benton.
Here.
Berkman.
Here.
Benelli.
Here.
Cantorino.
Here.
Cheney.
Here.
Dillard.
Here.
DeSalvo.
Present.
Ekis.
Here.
Fagion.
Here.
Hines.
Here.
Hemmings. Corsack. Padu.
Here.
Ruskevich.
Here.
Sullivan.
Here.
Vero.
Here.
Gresham. 21 present.
Okay, I'd like to welcome Savannah Ferrer. A youth bureau intern for community development. She is a 16-year-old from City of Middletown, and she will be entering her senior year at the Middletown High School. Rich Mayfield, do you want to take a photo?
I would like to, Mr. Chairman.
Next up, it gives me great pleasure to invite up Olivia Dolly Leibowitz on her 100th birthday and her extended family, Edward Wright, her sister, Linda and Ned Spreer, her niece and nephew, niece and husband, excuse me, Erwin and Tom Pacenza, niece and husband, Stacy Brescher Spreer, great niece, and Phyllis Brescher, and Deputy County Exec Wayne Booth and Mike Anagnostakis, her legislator. Mike, I'm going to let you go first.
It's hard to be lead off, but it's just amazing to be here with Dolly and her whole family. I met her in my first campaign, and you remember, we talked a few minutes ago. We met at the door, we had a lengthy conversation. Anyone that doesn't know her, do yourselves a favor at the end, talk to her. She'll tell you amazing things. She told me, but it's a secret, she said. She told me what the secret to longevity is. It's a secret between us right now. I'm speechless. You know that I send all my constituents birthday cards. So between you and I, a little secret, I looked everybody up, and you are my oldest constituent. It is. By the way, Mark, you get to 100 years old, and my God, the things that you probably see in your life. When you were born, women didn't even have the right to vote. And I'll tell you something about Dolly that you may not know. She is as civic-minded as any individual in Orange County. She has voted in every single election. God bless you. God bless your whole family. And I hope to be sending many, many, many birthday cards more to you. Pictures.
Next up, we have Wayne, Deputy County Exec, who was your former supervisor.
It's definitely an honor to be here. I couldn't say one of my oldest constituents. But going back to the secret, I'll tell you, I'm just going into my 60th year, and I don't look as good as you do now at 100. So I just, we really got to let the secret out. And it's just amazing how sharp this woman is. It's a little bit scary. I'm glad I'm not one of your relatives, where you would remember all my stories from my childhood. I just want to say congratulations. It's great to see you again, and congratulations to your whole family. We're just
thank you so much.
Yeah, Dolly, you are certainly an inspiration to all of us. I did save Barbara Bedell's column, which says just a few of the things that you've done over the years, from serving on committee to provide low-income housing to preschool immunization. She is the epitome of love, compassion, and sensitivity. Only recently, at age 99, she resigned from St. Luke's Hospital after 30 years of service. It was time, she said. She's been the church clerk for over 25 years and president of Beta Eta for 31. She has volunteered at the YMCA for years, served for 25 years at the Amos and Sarah Holden home, and the list goes on and on. And why doesn't the family all come up, Edna? Her baby sister, Edna, 94. And we have a proclamation. And I asked, Mike and Agnes Stakas last night said he only sent you one birthday card, but he's probably been at your door about 12 times, right? Yeah, you see, believe me, everybody in his constituency does. But he is very active, just like you. And I do have to say that Edna and Dolly both come from Tennessee, and they both married a Jewish gentleman from New York State. I asked them how that happened, and they alluded that they make better lovers. Jeff Berkman would appreciate it. But we're going to let Dolly say a few words after we give the proclamation. And I've been lucky to know Dolly and Edna over the years. They're family to me. I see them usually every Mother's Day right around that time. And just vibrant, vivacious, energetic ladies and come from good stock and have really made a difference in our community. So without further ado, I'm going to read you part of this resolution. A proclamation of the Orange County Legislature recognizing and honoring Olivia Dolly Leibowitz on the occasion of her 100th birthday. Whereas the essence of charity depends on as much as it does upon a kind heart, a sensitive nature, on a vitality and energy which conveys the fruits of the charitable spirit to those in need. And whereas a life devoted to good citizenship is measured not merely by one's compliance with the legal acceptable norms of society, but also by the extra efforts and voluntary activities assumed for the benefit of others and for the whole community. And whereas Olivia Dolly Leibowitz was born on August 1st, 1916, and resides in the town of Newburgh, she has been active in the Newburgh community for generations and has come to know many people during her lifetime. And whereas Olivia Dolly Leibowitz has been recognized and appreciated for her dedication to volunteerism, she has served on many committees, including the Committee to Provide Low-Income Housing. We said all this earlier. I think we got it in the article. Whereas longevity of life is blessed for an individual and for a community which benefits from the wisdom, creativity, and experiences this individual brings to all. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Orange County Legislature, do hereby extend the best wishes to Olivia Dolly Leibowitz on the occasion of her 100th birthday. with sincere congratulations for many more happy and productive years. And myself, Mike Anastakis, and Stephen Miller signed it. I'm just going to say a couple things after you give a speech.
Ladies and gentlemen of the Orange County Legislature and people in the audience, my family, I thank you for this honor. It's quite, it makes me feel very, very good to receive this honor. And my longevity was indeed a surprise. I never expected to live this long and have all the good health and the ability to do the things I've done. So I thank God for my blessings, and I thank you all for this honor.
Thank you, Dad. Everybody come up, please, and we'll take a group picture. And I do have to say that when you did get engaged to, you and your sister got engaged to the gentleman from New York, your father said, why'd you have to be a couple damn Yankees?
Your grandfather,
I'm sorry. We were saying damn Yankees Tuesday night when we were at the Mets Yankees game. Melissa, Barry, myself, and a few others. No, that's great. So everybody come up and we'll get a nice picture. Yes, he did, I'm sure. And one more thing, we did have a little video, but we couldn't get it because it was too loud, but it was you rapping, right? Yeah, that would have been great.
Too.
And finally, I'd say you wanted, one of your wishes is to ride in the back of a police car. Yes, if you act up a little bit out here later, we can rage out for you.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, this might be the appropriate time for me just to mention that I apologize for missing last month's meeting, but 1 month ago I was with 13 young men and women and several other advisors in London, England, participating in the World Championships of the Shell Eco Marathon. And I'm proud to come back and say that two of those individuals never left the city of Newburgh before. And I'm very proud to say that we come back here to the United States, 16th in the entire world in concept car.
Thank you
very
much. Thank you, Chris. Thank you for doing that. It's a big honor. Okay, lost my agenda. One second. There we go. We have one public participation. That's after, I'm sorry. Okay. Majority Leader Bonasek.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to approve the minutes of June 2nd, 2016.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Are there any referrals, withdrawals, or consents? Yes, Legislator Bureau.
I have one consent. I request consent to place on the agenda an act amending the management compensation plan and salary schedule for the Orange County Management Plan pursuant to section 2.02G and H of the Orange County Charter. I believe everybody has a copy of that in front of them.
Second.
Discussion? Okay, no objections? That'll be done. What'd you say? Pleasure. 28, save for the last. 28. Okay, AA is referred to all legislators. Yes. Withdraw? Okay, yes, Legislator Bonilla.
Thank you. I respectfully request that item number 24 on the agenda, resolution setting a date for a public hearing with respect to the proposal to amend the Orange County Sewer Law in relation to discharge of waste into the sewer collection system of the Harriman Sewer Treatment Plant be withdrawn from this agenda.
Second.
There are no objections. That'll be done. Okay, we ready for number one, Gene? Okay, agenda item number one.
Legislators Benton, Fagione, and Cantorino. An act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to abolish human resources associate at the Orange County Community College pursuant to section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bunnison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagione? Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduke, Riskevich, Sullivan, Bureau, Gresham, 21 ayes.
And number two?
Legislators Hines, Bonasic, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagione, Paduke, and Bureau. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature calling upon the Board of Trustees for St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital to reconsider its decision to close its emergency department at the Cornwall campus on October 1st, 2016.
Second.
Discussion? Yes. All Republicans? Michael, you were speaking, or you want to speak? Okay. Matt, all Democrats? Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I obviously didn't make it. The committee didn't went over this. Is there some reason there's a timetable on this of urgency to move this today?
Kevin, can you want to speak to that? Yes.
Sure. I would like to speak about it in its entirety. I found out the same day as the public safety meeting, first thing in the morning, and since this was an issue 3 years ago, it was kind of, well, it was easy for me to reenact the resolution because Antoinette did all the work. But she tweaked it a little to address the current issues. The hospital is going full speed ahead with this, from what I'm told, and it's just a matter of the state giving the hospital their blessing, which we believe may have already happened. So yes, timing is very essential. I know there are some law firms doing some work on it to try to honor the Stillman Trust. The Stillman family gave the property to the Cornwall Hospital, I believe, in 1931, and so that it remains a hospital. And when I met with the chairman of the board and the chairman of the hospital, met with invited elected officials from the area that they thought would be affected. And several legislators attended, county executive office was represented, Commissioner Casey was certainly there, and a lot of the local officials, and we were told that the board voted unanimously. That we weren't told that day, I was told that by somebody on the board, that the board voted unanimously. There's 17 people on this board, and when I did a little more research and spoke to one of the board members, they told me that many of the members weren't even present the day of the vote. So we're looking at that as well to find out who was actually present and voted. It's easy to say it was unanimous when you don't know how many people were there and how many were absent. In my mind, it shouldn't have said unanimous. They should have said 17 people on the board and however many were absent. So that decision we're still looking at. On behalf of the county, we conveyed our displeasure, and this resolution does it as well, that we were never consulted. They had this on the back burner and actually submitted it to the state without speaking to us. And as everybody here knows, that's a big problem for Orange County with respect to our incident management plans, with respect to public safety, Indian Point, the air show, a whole bunch of issues that Commissioner Casey, in his first week on the job, had to immediately start tackling with his staff. So I asked the board
that day of the elected officials meeting, can you still call it a hospital? And the chairman of the board, Michelle Ryder, who is an attorney, told me absolutely yes. They consulted with attorneys. They can still call it a hospital. That Monday night when the hospital board met with all of us from the public that wanted to attend at a meeting at Pier 9, I asked the same question and they said, oh yes, we can still call it a hospital. So then I gave them a for instance and I said, what happens if a tourist maybe from West Point is driving on Route 9W and starts having chest pains and they pull him to the Cornwall Hospital because there's a big sign that says St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital and they think that they're in pretty good shape and they pull in and there's nobody there. No matter what time of day, because the only treatment that goes on there is scheduled services, all outpatient things, there's no admitting. That person would then have to pick up the phone, dial 911, or our operator would hopefully know where they were, but if not, they'd have to say, I'm at the Cornwall Hospital and there's nobody here to help me. And I think that's one blatant medical malpractice, so I think they have to remove the hospital sign for that reason, and if they don't want to do that because it may violate the Stillman Trust. So I'm hoping that the fight is not over, but it may be. We also pointed out to them that if you go to the emergency room in Newburgh, you sort of celebrate when you get what I call a hall bed because there's not enough beds there to accommodate what they have now. The hospital says they treat 1.6 patients per hour, which if you extrapolate that out, that's about 250 a week, more than 1,000 a month. There's no way the Newburgh facility can handle that. Some of the local ambulance corps spoke at Pier 9 and they talked about the resources being thinned and a lot of them are still volunteers because the trip to St. Luke's from the Cornwall area or anywhere south, whether it be Highland Falls, Woodbury, Blooming Grove, you would add 11 minutes to the response to the hospital from if you were to pass Cornwall Hospital as they're being told they have to. Certainly if you're from the town of Highlands or Woodbury, you'd have to pass it. That 11 minutes is when you're going fast to the hospital. However, when you turn the patient over to an already overcrowded hospital, and then you have to drive back at regular speed to your jurisdiction area, you're talking more than probably 40 minutes per call. And then we have could have a shortage of ambulances or our resources would certainly be taxed. I asked the chairman of the board, did they do a study on how many people will die as a result of this? And she said, point blank, no. And I said, well, how many do you think will die? And she said, I don't have a crystal ball. So there wasn't a lot of thought going into this in my mind. I think the closing of the ER is bad, irresponsible, dangerous. It's a bad decision for all of Eastern Orange County because you're gonna cause overcrowding in Newburgh. That's already a problem. So it's all of Eastern Orange County. It's not just Southeast Orange County. So I ask all my colleagues to please support this resolution and do whatever you can to continue the fight. The state of New York just handed them $14 million, and they returned with that saying, okay, now we're gonna provide less services. So, I don't know. My feelings, I live in Cornwall, I was born in that hospital, and I think it's an atrocious decision. Thank you.
Okay, Legislator Aimo, I'm sorry, we weren't finished over.
No, I think I have several questions. I got more of an answer than I expected, but that's okay. I guess my concern is why we didn't bring it before Health and Mental Health Committee to talk about. Certainly do not deny any of the issues that Mr. Hines raised regarding emergency services or public safety. What I am concerned about is the quality of care that is delivered in a hospital or any center that has not enough staff giving the appropriate amount of treatment to be at the top of their game. And those of us in any healthcare background know that the real correlative to any quality of care is the frequency of delivery of services. You want a surgeon that does 5,000 procedures, that's the one you want. You don't want someone that's done five. You want to have a job, you want to survive. So when we talk about an emergency room, do we have the highest quality of emergency delivery, and is that relevant? So it's the other half of the equation. I understand the community support, I understand the political thing, I think we should be talking about the quality. It may be bad for that one person on the highway who has a heart attack coming in, as Mr. Hines presented, but it could be even worse for the four or five people who show up and are actually presented to people who have never confronted the illness or the emergency that they've had, they present in front of them. And now they're gonna have to deal with someone who, I don't wanna say a rookie, but somebody that's never done with that particular procedure. That could be equally as bad. I think we need to weigh both. And I would hope that we would have the opportunity, I don't think we need to stop it here, but I think we should have the opportunity to discuss the quality of care at that location and have the health commissioner talk to that about us so that we're able to understand fully what our, the impact of our decision would be. Thank you.
Legislator Anagnostakis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Certainly, I will be supporting this resolution, and I thank Mr. Hines for moving it forward. But there are a few things that everyone needs to understand, I think. Number one, Orange County government particularly does not have any jurisdiction over this hospital and its decisions. Number two, this action occurred after we, to address Mr. Amo, and he has valid questions and concerns. This happened after we had our last health and mental health meeting. Then this event occurred, and to break some news to everybody, Gene is the only one that actually knows about this. In that time since that event occurred, I have been in negotiations with the hospital, the highest personnel in that hospital, to get them in front of the next meeting of the Health and the Mental Health Committee to, number one, allow them to make their presentation to tell us how it is that they got themselves in this situation. And we have to understand there are decisions that are made on a higher level in the county, specifically the federal government and the state government, and how healthcare is treated right now that has got them in this position. So I wanted them to explain their position, number one, without having people grandstanding. Number two, then we would allow all legislators, especially the committee members, to question them and go back and forth, question and answer. So they were open to that, and a few days into this negotiation process, when they understood, finally, that the public will be there and the press could be there, they wanted no part of it. So they're happy, quote unquote, to meet with anybody privately, but they don't want to go in front of the public and the press, in front of a committee, to answer questions and make a presentation. So the upshot is they will not be showing up to the Health and Mental Health Committee. Gene, we don't have to book that bigger room that we were thinking of. But we will have Dr. Avila at the next meeting, and he'll talk about some of these issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Legislator Ekus.
Thank you. And I don't want to repeat too much of what's been said, but I think we do need some clarification. Again, I want to give you the timeline that Legislator Hines put out. We found out, basically, I found out about this at 3:30 on a Thursday, and we were summoned into a leadership meeting. Anybody who supposedly was in an elected position and cared at 11:30 Friday morning. Then the public hearing was held, or the public, we could call it a hearing because they did allow everybody to speak, was held Monday, the following Monday, at 6:00 at night. And by everybody's admission, okay, the advertising for that public hearing was horrendous, and thank heavens for some fellow elected officials, I'm not gonna say yay or nay on who they were, but for putting out robocalls and getting as many people to that hearing as possible. When we were told by the hospital in the leadership meeting about the closing, they continually referred to 5.2 miles, 5.2 miles. That's all it is 5.2 miles. But, and I am not an EMS person, but I can tell you that every EMS person that came to me, it's not the mileage. So if somebody tries to tell you it's 5.2 miles, that's bogus. It's time. It's time that counts. And that's the first thing that an EMS person will learn in their training and so on like that. The second is, what Mr. Amo mentioned, you know, I'm concerned about the quality. And he gave us a scenario about what happens if they go to the Cornwall Hospital and, you know, they're diagnosed by some rookie doctor, I think was the term used. The same doctors that man the ER at St. Luke's take time manning the ER in Cornwall. So the level of quality really did not or has not changed at all, just to let you know. Now, I will tell you that the doctors did vote to close Cornwall, and the reason they voted to close Cornwall was because they've taken everything out of Cornwall. They've taken all the equipment away. They've taken everything. So in some circumstances, the individuals that need to be admitted have to be put back in an ambulance and taken over to St. Luke's. But I don't think that the quality has changed there. And in reference to quality, one of the interesting things in their proposal to us as leaders was the fact that it's not a problem. There are 5, 6, 7, I believe they actually use 9, but it's not 9, either urgent care or emergency care centers in the immediate area around Cornwall Hospital. Most of those emergency care centers are closed at 5 o'clock. So half of a day is not being taken care of right there, unless we can get them to, of course, open up longer and all. Secondly, as I mentioned to them, and I think Legislator Hines will vouch for this, twice, at both the leadership meeting and then at the public meeting, I asked them about educating the public. We tend to agree that urgent care has developed and that more serious types of perhaps injuries, twisted ankles, and so on like that can be treated there. We certainly would want anybody who can be treated at an emergency care center or urgent care center to go there and not to necessarily go to the ER and clog that up. But in both cases, they denied, as Mr. Hines mentioned, even receiving $14 million from the state, they denied it was their responsibility to educate the general public on what urgent care and immediate care facilities can do. They left us in the lurch. I think right out of the gate, the first thing that you have to be upset about is the process. You know, we complain about sometimes our process here. Their process was horrendous. If this was ultimately going to happen, if it was going to happen because of fiscal reasons, which is what they gave us, I think it could have happened in a much easier, more palatable way to everybody, and in a safer way to everybody, a much safer way to everybody. And I'm continuing to look into it. I know Mr. Hines is also, and there are other people out there, to see if we can't at least belay this and do it in a more sensible way. Thank you.
Legislator Amo.
I just want to clarify that. I didn't refer to any professionals as a rookie, or if I did it, that's not what my intent was. My intent was the frequency of a service could put someone in a situation that they're being treated by somebody who is up on top of the technique as much as they should be. I wasn't calling them that way. I may have misused the word. You know, and I think the other question we need to look at, and maybe Mr. Hines knows the difference, it's an Article 28 facility, I suspect, so therefore it's regulated by the health department, and that means it's a hospital. And when you start talking about why they don't get involved in urgency centers, I don't think urgency centers are Article 28 facilities. They're what people in the industry call doc in a box. You're a physician, you open up a practice, and you're not regulated by the health department. You're a private practice. And so when you're asking the hospital to start working on an urgency center to help them educate, it's sort of like they're not related at all in terms of the regulatory environment.
Anybody else? Well, I'd just like to commend Legislator Hines for bringing this forward. He represents that area, and there is urgency. And, you know, we would like to hear more facts, but this is a memorialization, and we are all concerned. I think there's bipartisan support for this. And, you know, hopefully there isn't devastating effects down at the St. Luke's Hospital. I mean, the future looks bleak there. It certainly does. It's a very pessimistic outlook this time. I mean, everybody did what they could do last time to save the situation, but... you know, if we want to talk about this at health and mental health and strengthen next month's resolution, have another resolution and do whatever we can to rectify the situation and get more facts, certainly let's do that. But thank you, Legislator Hines, for bringing this today and bringing it to public safety. Roll call? Read the resolution. I'm sorry. Roll call. That was right.
Monasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
No.
Anastakis?
Yes.
Benton? Berkman, Benelli, Cantorino,
yes.
Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo,
yes.
Ekis, Baggione, Hines,
yes.
Kemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk,
yes.
Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero,
yes.
Gresha. 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, resolution number 3.
Legislators Cheney, Cantorino, Paduk, and Bonasek. Resolution confirming the appointment of Brendan R. Casey as Commissioner of Emergency Services for Orange County by the County Executive pursuant to Section 26.01 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes. Majority Leader Bonasek.
Thank you. First of all, all Republicans would like to be added to this, please. And I just wanted to say very quickly, in anticipation of this passing momentarily, I just want to welcome you aboard. Your experience and professionalism, we're very fortunate. to have you choose Orange County to serve in this capacity, so I just wanted to say good luck and thank you for coming.
Legislator Hines, then Ekus, and then Minority Leader Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was asked to be on the selection committee by the county executive. I was honored to serve. We had a lot of highly qualified individuals apply, but Brendan certainly rose to the top. He and I sit on the police advisory board in the county, so I've come to know him quite well. And he was a perfect fit because all the police chiefs in Orange County already knew him because he was the captain of the state police, really commanding this area. I know he was praised for his handling of the air show last year when we did have that unfortunate event there. He was the incident commander and showed that he was a great leader and could certainly handle any challenges that come before us. So I think it was an excellent suggestion, and I sort of urged him to apply for the job, although I think someone beat me to it before he applied. But the state police, I guess, lost a good leader, but we took him on, so I hope everybody supports him, and I welcome him and look forward to continue to work with him. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. This is an outstanding gentleman with an outstanding resume. I am really pleased that he's there. As mentioned, because of the hospital closing, he was throwing curveballs right out of the gate. And I am very impressed with the fact that he was right there at the meeting with the leadership. And I think that's exactly the way that he's going to be here in this office. And so I just can't help but recommend him myself. And I would like to be added to the resolution, please.
Absolutely. Matt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Also like to be added as a sponsor. Again, I'd like to point out that we've identified Hamptonburg as a resource. And many talented people, I think our recycling person also came from Hamptonburg. This is a challenging position. And although I don't know Mr. Casey, I know people that do know him. He comes highly recommended. He's also got big shoes to fill. I'm expecting great things from him.
Legislator Amy.
Thank you. I met him at a roundtable meeting and was impressed. And we're so impressed that I'd like to have all the members of my caucus.
Anybody else? Yes, Vernon. Add your name, Jim. Okay. Hey, Katie, you're already on, right? Or you want to say something? Okay. Hamptonburg is close to Blooming Grove.
Well, not only is Hamptonburg close to Blooming Grove, but Brandon comes from Blooming Grove.
He went to school in Blooming Grove, right?
Okay. Well, Washingtonville, born and bred.
And I've happened.
He worked in Monroe.
Yes, and he worked in Monroe. So here he is, a true Orange County individual. And as my colleagues have said, he is an excellent choice for this position. Totally suited towards his talents. And I look forward to working with him. I've known him for a long time, and I'm very pleased to see you here today and be able to appoint you to this position. Congratulations.
All Democrats have it too. I too was on the selection committee, and I was very impressed with Brendan. I mean, his credentials jumped off the page. I think it's going to be a seamless transition, even though he's got big shoes to follow. His family is a little bit relieved that now he's going to be in a little bit safer environments, though not much less stressful. I will tell you that, Jill. You know, so and his wife Jill is here as well too. Okay, roll call.
Honison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino?
Yes.
Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekus? Spagione? Hines? Kemenetz? Kulisek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Bureau? Brescia? 21 ayes.
Congratulations.
Thank you all. I won't let you down.
And we know you won't.
I'll go make a promise.
Back to work.
Back to work. Upstairs. Celebrate after 5. Okay, resolution number 4.
Legislators Ekus, Bonasek, Benton, Hines. Bond resolution dated August 4th, 2016. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing financing for telephone system improvements for the Department of Emergency Services, stating estimated maximum cost thereof is $240,000, a
appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of 240,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch? 21 ayes.
Okay, number five.
Legislators Fagion, Bonison, Benton, Berkman. Resolution authorizing the Orange County Department of Emergency Services Police Liaison Services to transfer funds from a general fund to restore Alive at 25 revenue pursuant to section 4.10 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Chris?
Please add my name to it.
Yes, certainly. Paduk added. Okay, roll call. Steve.
Yes.
Yeah. Be added. Early and Roseanne also.
Bonison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch? 21 ayes.
And number six?
Legislators Fagion, Sullivan, Bonison, and Hines. Local law introductory number 11 of 2016. A local law amending local law number 2 of 2013. Fixing the compensation for the chairperson of the Orange County Legislature to be effective for the term commencing on January 1st, 2018, pursuant to section 2.02S of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Majority Leader Bonasek, I'm sorry.
6 through 12?
Yeah, I don't see a problem. Okay. Legislator Anagnestakis?
That's what I was going to ask.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? Emo? Yes, you want to comment?
Yeah. I think we're going to have a replay of this one because I'm probably be the only one voting no on this one. And I did make a presentation in committee and obviously lost there and I'll lose here, but that's all right. I really think that we were doing this for probably the wrong reason. We're probably worried about what the public's going to think about whether or not people get a raise or don't get a raise. And so to add 0% for another 4 years to elected officials, and we're going to go through them all, is something that just doesn't square with me. So when you look at the inflation rate that our elected officials are going to be experiencing, and it doesn't apply to me, I really don't care, but I think we have to weigh it in the position to realize that depending on who you look, what data you look at, it could be as between 2 and 3% inflation rate averaged over the next 3 years. We've already taken health care. We've already diminished the cost that the county pays by health care by asking elected officials to pay a percentage, something of 12% of their salary to pay for health care. A few years ago, we eliminated mileage, so people wanted to come to the Orange County Legislative meetings or to any meetings that had to do with elected officials. They weren't entitled to reimbursement, which again lost probably $200 or $300 a year just in terms of travel to meetings. All of these things add up to the cost of what we're doing over the next few years. And I think what it's really going to cause for us is create a compensation package where people who do not need any money, who don't have a desire to make any money, will want to run for this office. If someone wants to run for this office and needs to have additional money to cover their inflationary costs, their travel, or other kind of expenses, this is going to be a deterrent. Why not stay at the local level, or they can walk to the meetings or whatever and get all the health benefits everybody else they want? Why do they want to participate in any other elected position? And I think the interesting thing is, it's sort of a subtle thing, maybe it's a little stretch, but we're also sort of challenging our ethics law. You know, if you ask someone not to make any more money and they need it, the logical thing is they're going to try to find ways to make more money. How many of them can make mistakes? Let's realize we should be paying our elected officials what they're worth.
Roll call.
Bonison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
No.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch? 20 ayes, 1 no.
Number seven.
Legislators Fagion, Sullivan, Bonasic, and Hines, Local Law Introductory Number 12 of 2016, a local law amending Local Law Number 3 of 2013, fixing the compensation for the majority and minority leaders of the Orange County Legislature to be effective for the term commencing on January 1st, 2018, pursuant to Section 2.02S of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
No.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Hemnitz? Kulisek? Padoue? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Biro? Bresch? 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 8.
Legislators Fagion, Sullivan, Bonasic, Hines, Local Law Introductory Number 13 of 2016, a local law amending Local Law Number 4 of 2013, fixing the compensation for chairpersons of the statutory committees of the Orange County Legislature to be effective for the term commencing on January 1st, 2018, pursuant to Section 2.02S of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Jeff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm voting no on this one, but for somewhat of a different reason than Mr. Amo articulated. Partly all of these salary proposals that we're voting on, resolutions, it could have been much better process and vetted beforehand. It seems like a lot of legislators were up one day, down the other, and wasn't really a thoughtful process as I'd like it to be. I've been doing a lot of thinking myself about how we govern ourselves and what our charter responsibilities are. When I think about the committee chairs, let's face the truth. I mean, it's a political process that picks the chairman. And I'm not faulting you, Mr. Chairman, because that's in the charter. And I'm not faulting any of your predecessors either. I'm just saying I don't think that that's necessarily the best way to govern ourselves. I think we'd be better off if we had a mixed system where we had closer reflection to what the enrollment is of the people of Orange County. I just think maybe it's an idealistic vision, but that's what I'd like to see. And I think some of the chairmen and some of the committees really rely on the staff and aren't really all that active in putting together the agendas. Others, granted, work very diligently, but this this proposal kind of maintains the same supplemental incomes, the stipend, over the basic legislative pay. So I think it could actually be reduced. Now that I've stated that, of course, to the committee chairman on the committees I serve, you're all really hardworking people. But because I have to go back to work with you guys. But you know, at least consider what I said. I'm voting no.
Minority Leader Turnbull.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On a different note, I'll be voting no also. As I've said in the past, although there are more registered Democrats in the County of Orange, not one has a chairmanship. I think there's 8 statutory and 2 ad hoc committees, maybe 3 ad hoc committees. None of these chairmen are Democrats. In my opinion, this is just not representative government, so I'll be voting no.
Okay, roll call.
Bonasic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
No.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman?
No.
Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard?
No.
DeSalvo? Ickes?
Yes.
Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Padoue?
No.
Ruskevich, Sullivan,
yes.
Biro,
yes.
Brescia, 16 ayes.
Okay, number 10. I know. Okay, number 10.
Yeah. Legislators Fagion, Sullivan, Bonasic, and Hines, Local Law Introductory Number 14 of 2016. a local law amending Local Law Number 5 of 2013, fixing the compensation for legislators of the Orange County Legislature to be effective for the term commencing on January 1st, 2018, pursuant to Section 2.02S of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion?
Yes.
Chris?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, again. It's amazing what we're doing here. And I understand those who are reticent about voting yes for this, but we're doing it for the citizens of this county. And we're doing it for the right reasons. And we have a choice. And I really want to say, I know everybody reads the newspaper, it is my true hope that the state looks at us as a model on what should be done and how it should be done. And I would like my name added to this particular resolution, please.
Okay, roll call.
Bonacy?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
No. Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard?
No.
DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Hemnitz, Corsick, Paduke, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Rescher, 19 ayes, 2 noes.
Number 10.
Legislators Fagion, Sullivan, Bonacek, and Hines. Local law introductory number 15 of 2016. A local law amending Local Law 6 of 2013, fixing the compensation for the county executive of Orange County to be effective for the term commencing on January 1st, 2018, pursuant to Section 2.02G of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Quick question. Okay, I'm sorry, that's why I'm screwed up. Okay, I gotta get my numbers right here. All right, discussion? Roll call.
Bonacy?
Yes.
Turnbull? Amo?
No.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Fagion, Hines, Hemnitz, Corsick, Paduke, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Rescher. 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 11, yep.
Legislators Fagion, Sullivan, Bonacek, and Hines. Local law introductory number 16 of 2016. A local law amending Local Law Number 7 of 2013 and fixing the compensation for the County Clerk of Orange County to be effective for the term commencing on January 1st, 2018, pursuant to Section 2.02G of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
No.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo, Ekis, Fagion, Hines, Hemnitz, Corsick, Paduke, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Rescher. 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, 12, receive and file, number 12.
Legislators Bonacek, Benelli, and Corsick. Resolution appointing David C. Green a Commissioner of Elections pursuant to Sections 3-200 and 3-204 of the Election Law and Act No. 3 of 1936 of the former Orange County Board of Supervisors.
Second.
Discussion?
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis, Fagion, Hines, Hemnitz, Corsick,
no.
Paduke, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Rescher. 20 ayes, 1 no.
And number 13.
Legislators Bonacek, Benelli, and Corsick. Resolution appointing Susan Barron, Commissioner of Elections, pursuant to Sections 3-200 and 3-204 of the Election Law and Act No. 3 of 1936 of the former Orange County Board of Supervisors.
Second.
Discussion? Yes.
May I have my name added to it, please?
Yes, Chris. Okay, roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagione, Hines, Hemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresha. 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 14.
Legislators Bonasek, Kulisek, Benelli. Resolution calling on all state, county, and local officials, residents, and business owners to adopt the Think Differently initiative to assist individuals with special needs and their families.
Second.
Hey, has met?
All Dems.
Okay. All Republicans? Okay, I just wanted my name added to, well, I'm with the Republicans, I'm sorry. Michael's joke, okay? I would think I am, right? I just... A long time ago, I was on the other side, and I crossed over.
Change your registration.
Yeah. It's not that old, right? I just have to say that I have a son that's on the autism spectrum, so I wholeheartedly endorse this, and I think we do need to think differently and, you know, open up opportunities for those in that area. So I definitely support this. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yeah.
Amo? Anagnostakis, Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSavo, Ekis, Fagione, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresha. 21 ayes.
Number 15.
Legislators Ekis, Cheney, Bonasek, and Hines. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature authorizing the inclusion of certain real property in Orange County Agricultural Districts Numbers 1 and 2, pursuant to New York State Agriculture and Markets Law, Section 303B.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, ma'am.
And my name.
Your name? Okay. Matt's name? Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagione? Hines? Hemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresha. 21 ayes.
Okay, number 16.
Legislators Cheney and Benton. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Consumer Affairs and Weights and Measures to enter into reciprocal licensing agreements with various counties and cities.
Second.
Discussion? Jeff's added.
Added, or you want to talk?
Buck?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Tom wants to talk.
There was a question in caucus about whether there was a fee imposed in the reciprocation. And if I could get some clarification on that, my memory is that there is a hefty fee involved.
I thought there was as well. Can anybody clarify that?
Yeah. I think it was $500.
I thought it was $500 too.
Yes.
Are you sure it's $500?
So I pay the application fee.
Okay, discussion? Tom, I'm sorry.
Chairman, thank you. I just want to appreciate the fact that the county is being proactive in encouraging other counties, and especially our cities here in Orange County, to enter into this reciprocity agreement. As the only legislator that represents an entire city, the city of Port Jervis, I have encouraged the city government, the city of Port Jervis, to really look at this agreement here. Unfortunately, the city of Port Jervis has not entered into this agreement, but I am going to be working with the electrical, the building inspector in Port Jervis. What this does is this allows licensed master electricians in Orange County to work in these municipalities that agree in this reciprocity. And unfortunately for the city of Port Jervis, they have chosen not to get into this. So I'm looking forward to work with the city of Port Jervis, and hopefully the next time this comes up, we will be glad to have the city of Port Jervis included as well. Thank you, Chairman.
Gary?
Just a clarification. When we enter this reciprocity agreement, an individual who is an electrician who qualifies because of their status in another jurisdiction then has to apply for licensure here in Orange County, and the reverse is the same, either a local municipality or another county, and pay whatever the fee is for that jurisdiction.
Thank you. And Legislator Cantorino add his name to this. Any further discussion? Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Fagione, Hines, Hemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresha. 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 17.
Legislators Ekis and Cantorino. Resolution authorizing the county executive, in conjunction with the Orange County Youth Bureau, to accept and appropriate additional funding from the New York State Office of Children and Family Services pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second. Discussion? Chairman wants to be added? Okay. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Nagustakis? Benton? Berkman? Vanelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Hemnitz? Korsak? Padu? Buskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 18.
Legislators Cantorino and Ekis, resolution making a supplemental appropriation to the 2016 Orange County budget for the Orange County Youth Bureau pursuant to Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Legislator Paduk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a point, you know, they just got 10 grand additional, and we're going to fund them $5,100, which is over, for the consultant and the awards, when I think normally they already have an amount in the budget that they use. There was no oversight, or maybe 500 people that weren't expected came, or it just seems odd to me that they're asking for additional funding for the Youth Bureau in that regard, and they just got $10,130 extra from baking. So, I don't know, maybe it's a thing they could look at.
Legislator Buskevich wanted to say something.
Yeah, we did discuss this last night at caucus. There was some confusion. I did speak with Nancy at the Youth Bureau this morning, and what this is basically, they're taking the money from the 600 fund, which is a fund that was set up many years ago specifically for this luncheon, and that money's already been transferred. So essentially, what this resolution is doing is just putting that money in the proper budget lines. Okay. They're working within their budget. We're not giving them any additional money.
Okay, good. Good. Kevin asked the same question last night.
The 600 fund is where the money for all the events, I guess, for the Youth Bureau is held. I didn't know that. That was one of my questions, too, is what is the 600 fund? I didn't know what that was.
Okay, and I know they had over 500 at the luncheon at the Holiday Inn. So. 530 is a great crowd, which is a good thing. So. Okay, any other discussion? Roll call.
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Nagustakis? Benton? Berkman?
No.
Vanelli? Cantorino?
Yes.
Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Hemnitz? Korsak? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 19.
Legislators Nagustakis, Sullivan, and Bonacek. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Office for the Aging to accept and appropriate donation funds pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I noticed in the resolved second, the first one actually, this additional money which is donated out of an estate of Lucy Kohler is to be spent in the city of Middletown, and I hope that important detail is not overlooked. Now, I'm curious how they're going to spend the extra $10,000 on that existing program, but it's small enough that I have confidence in the people running the program.
But we know with that keyword Middletown in there, you're going to go for it.
Can I have my name on there, please?
Yes, you can. All right. Any discussion further? Roll call. Mike?
Just can have my name added as well.
Yes, you can.
I did talk about this in our caucus a little bit because, you know, going specifically to Middletown in this year's budget. So we've already budgeted money for the senior dining program in Middletown. So I was hoping to hear something maybe from the Office of the Aging. Maybe Ms. Maglione could give us some information in regards to what this extra $10,000 is going to be used for. I thought maybe they were going to upgrade fish sticks to filet mignon, which...
I don't know, Middletown really hit the jackpot this year. The Heritage Trail, $10 million from the state. I mean, how much work can we give Middletown?
We're invited for that meal. At least the people that represent Middletown.
Fish sticks for them. Right? All right, roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Nagustakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion, Hines, Kemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresha. 21 ayes.
Okay, number 20.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the application for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2016 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to section 554 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Okay, discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Diller? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresha. 21 ayes.
Okay, number 21, bond resolution requiring two-thirds vote.
Legislators Kulisek, Benton, Benelli. Bond resolution dated August 4th, 2016. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing Phase 1 and Phase 2 environmental remediation improvements to the Orange County landfill, mandated by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation consent decree, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $1,400,000, appropriating $1 million, therefore, in addition to the $400,000 previously appropriated, and authorizing the issuance of $1 million bonds of the county to finance said additional appropriation.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresha. 21 ayes.
Okay. 22. Let's move.
Legislators Benelli and Benton, resolution setting a date for a public hearing with respect to the proposal of an increase in improvement to Orange County Sewer District Number 1.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call. Okay, you're on.
Thank you.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagion, Hines, Kemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresha. 21 ayes.
Mr. Chairman, please note the date and time of the public hearing.
The date and time?
Yeah.
What is the date?
August 23rd, 2016 at 5:15.
Okay, number 23.
Legislators Benelli and Riskevich, resolution setting a date for a public hearing with respect to the proposal of an increase in improvement to Orange County Sewer District Number 1.
Second.
Discussion?
Yeah.
You want to be added? Okay.
Yeah.
Yep, Jim's added. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines, Kemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresha. Again, the public hearing August 23rd, 2016 at 5:15.
Okay, number 25.
Legislators Riskevich and Kulisek, resolution of the Orange County Legislature reaffirming parts 1, 2, and 3 under State Environmental Quality Review Act CEQA with respect to the rehabilitation of the House Street Bridge in the Village of Warwick, New York, classifying the action as unlisted and determining that the action will not result in any significant adverse environmental impact.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman?
No.
Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresha. 20 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 26.
Legislators Riskevich and Benelli, resolution of the Orange County Legislature authorizing a fee acquisition of a parcel of real property situated in the Village of Warwick, County of Orange, State of New York, in connection with the project known as the House Street Bridge and Rehabilitation and Detour Roadway.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek? Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresha. 21 ayes.
Okay, number 27.
Legislators Paduk and Benelli, resolution of the Orange County Legislature authorizing a fee acquisition of a parcel of real property situated in the town of Mount Hope, County of Orange, State of New York, in connection with the culvert replacement project known as Drainage Rehabilitation Project, County Road Number 60.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 28, final.
Legislators Vero and Cheney, an act amending the management compensation plan and salary schedule for the Orange County Management Plan pursuant to Section 2.02G and H of the Orange County Charter.
Second?
Second.
Second, okay. Discussion? Yes, minority leader Turnbull.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it's unfortunate the way this resolution is coming up on consent. Last month it failed 10-9, and actually what happened was it takes 11 votes to pass, and there was only 10 votes, so it failed. I don't want to represent what happened. Now, I assumed that it was going to go back to committee for discussion. I got involved, I started having discussions. Roseanne Sullivan got very involved in it. I talked to Steve Gross about some possibilities and sitting down with him and having a discussion. Subsequently, I found out that you're going to bring it forward on consent. I think we reserve consent for special situations. This is not one of those special situations. I don't see what the rush is. Certainly, whenever we can improve on something, that's what we should do. I can remember last session or the session before that we were criticized for coming to this full session without having asked the right questions in committee, and I pointed out that sometimes some of these resolutions are, you know, demand more than one round at a committee. Sometimes we hear a proposal and you know, not at that time, but later on, we may do some research and find some things out that we'd like to present. I think this is a case where, you know, we can improve on this resolution, or at least let's have the discussion. You know, maybe it can't be improved upon. Maybe 3% this year, 3% next year is the way we'll end up going. But I think it deserves a round of discussion and debate. Roseanne Sullivan's done a lot of work on this. She's submitted a paper that we all have now. And, you know, this, I'm sure, is a rough draft. You know, you can look at it and see some things probably that are incorrect. But I think at the very least, it's an indication that we can do something for the county, something that improves the effectiveness and the fairness of this resolution. We all know that a lot of our managers have been, you know, they've been employed at the cap. You know, this is something that I think needs a second look. So I'd like to make a motion to send it back to committee for more discussion.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to send back to committee. Discussion on the motion.
Second.
Already have a second, Marty. Okay.
Yes, Jeff, and then Roseanne.
I think that the statement that Mr. Turnbull said is one I agree with. I think we could benefit from listening to the proposal that Legislator Sullivan is putting together, and I think we could have our input. And usually when something's sent back, it goes back to the committee. So it was a surprise to me and to many people of the our caucus as to why we're voting on it without having the benefit of a full conversation in committee where I think it should appropriately be placed.
Okay, nobody else is going to speak. I will take full credit or full blame for, okay, I'm sorry, Roseanne. Go ahead, I'm sorry, my fault.
I gave out a spreadsheet that I put together, Actually, the first few columns come straight from a report that Steve Gross gave us last year. And the last four columns is something that I put together based on his information. We have an opportunity here to do something really smart. We have, obviously, some employees who've been here for such a long time and haven't seen their salaries move at all. And that is just really unfortunate. Just a very bad place to be, I think, if I was in one of those positions. And we're throwing those people in the same pot as other people who just maybe been hired last year or the year before. And whereas they're all very important employees and we want to give them an incentive to stay, I don't believe that they should be treated the same. And we've learned that through our negotiations with unions. So, like I said, we have an opportunity to do something smart here, to go ahead and study the positions that we're asked to move on. And what I've done is I took if you see the first column, the positions actually, these weren't in this order in Steve's report. What I did was I separated them by longevity. So the first bulk of people there have been here for one to 9 years of service, the second 10 to 14, 15 through 19, and then finally people who have 20 years of service and more. And instead of giving a 3% raise straight across the board or 2.75, I went with the 2.75 for those who have 20 years or more of service, and then went down to 2.25, 1.75, 1.25, which is pretty close to the CPI. Just to give you an idea, not that this is anything that I'm proposing for an amendment or anything, but I want
is this
to just
point
take
of
a
order?
Look at this.
Roseanne, hang on.
If you let me get to my point, I just want you to take a look at this and look at it as something that we could be studying. Or perhaps there are things that we have not looked at. Perhaps giving a 2.75% raise straight across the board is not actually the fair way to go. And it's not incentivizing anybody to stay here. And I think, as I said before, we could be a lot smarter with this. Not only can we be saving a lot of money for the county as well, but if you compound that and look at what we're doing every single year and just throwing out 3% raises, this is not being the most conservative here. And I think we need to take another look at it. And it definitely deserves to be brought back to committee. And I, too, am a little surprised that it wasn't brought back to committee. But I would like to have the chance to discuss it there. This isn't something that we should be doing every single year. This is something that we need to plan ahead in order to do something right for the county. Fair for the employees and fair for the taxpayers. Something that we need to study further.
Okay. I'll say what I started to say. I will take the blame or the credit for bringing this back by consent. I think we've discussed this fully over the last year or so. Last year, we would have passed the extended raising of the caps, and we call it raise, but it's raising the caps, which gives you an ability to give raises, the county exec to give the ability to give raises to management, a third of which is already at the cap and has been so for a long, long time. I mean, it hasn't really been addressed. Last year was since 2004, I believe, correct? We discussed this last year, and it would have passed had some of us thought to amend it on the floor. If we had come a fraction below 10%, it would have passed last year, and we wouldn't be talking about this today. Last month, I'll take the blame. I was away, I screwed up and scheduled my vacation when there was a meeting. It would have passed last month. So nothing is new here. We fully vetted this in committee, and these amendments or these changes could have been brought up a long time ago. And if we pass this today, and I think it will pass by two votes, if not one vote, it doesn't preclude us from bringing this back to committee and having amending what we're doing. Correct, Steve? So I see no reason to delay this. And nobody had any of these suggestions when we discussed it in committee in June or last year. So it's just giving the ability to managers to get up to the cap, or the county exec to give raises up to the cap. Okay? We treat our managers like second-class citizens sometimes. Employees are the backbone of this county. We all know that. Well, let's not forget that managers are employees too. We try to, some of us treat them as second-class citizens. They go hand in glove, or like a backbone and a back supporter with this county. And they work together day in and day out. Now, we settled every contract within the last year, or a little over a year or so, give or take. A little over a year. We settled all the contracts, and there was nary a complaint about any one of them. And many of them were retro. This is only retro for about 7 months. Correct? 7 months, maybe back to the beginning of the year, 16 and 17, to raise it up to the 3% cap. Nobody complained about any of those except in the district attorney's office, the one union contract in the district attorney. That's the only complaint I heard, Michael. That's it. Nobody complained about any of the other ones. We took care of every other employee with their contracts. But now, management, we can't talk about it. I strongly suggest you do not send this back to committee and we vote here and now. Legislator Turnbull, Minority Leader.
Yeah, I agree with the chairman. We have a responsibility to the managers of the county, but we also have a responsibility to the citizens of Orange County, and I think that responsibility trumps, I didn't mean to use that word, the responsibility of the managers. But I think the point is there's no reason why we can't do both. I'm just a big fan of, we've made mistakes in the past, we know that. And every single mistake that we've made has been the result of pushing something through without properly vetting it. And I think this is an example of that.
Further discussion on the motion to send back to committee. No vote is to not send it back to committee. Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
No.
Turnbull?
No. Yes.
Yes.
You're over.
Emo?
Yes.
No. Anagnostakis?
No.
Benton?
No.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
No.
Cantorino?
No.
Cheney?
No.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
No.
Ekis?
Yes.
Fagione?
No.
Hines?
No.
Chemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Ruskevich?
No.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Piero?
No.
Gresham?
No, sorry.
18 ayes. 13 no's.
Okay, now back to the motion.
8,
not 18. You're getting like me, Gene. I do it to you. We're all screwed. Yeah. Okay, now we're back to the motion itself. It's 13 no's. Back to the motion. Are we ready to call the question? Legislator Anagnostakis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree with you that we should just move ahead and take a vote on this. But I don't agree that we should be passing this. And I'll tell you my reasoning. You're right. Every single employee in Orange County is critical, is important to the function of this county, and is valued, I think. And they're valued by the pay that they get. Some people get paid $140,000, some people get paid $38,000. Some legislators get paid $33,000, some get paid $29,000. Everybody gets paid according to what their value and their position that they do. But when it comes time to give an increase, we don't treat everybody the same. And I think we should. And I'm glad the legislative body took the lead again to do zeros for legislators. But if it's good enough for legislators, it should be good enough for every employee, regardless of what they make. Or if it's good enough for 3% raises for some employees, then why are we fighting to get the union at 1.5%? Why are we fighting to get legislators, elected officials at zero? My point is, if you had a policy where you treated everybody fairly and everybody equally, they all get paid according to what their position and title is and what they do for this county, they get a monetary value, and then everybody gets treated equally when it comes time for increases in pay, and of course you base it on inflation and other things, that would, I think, go a long way to getting unity within this legislative body. If you had a practice that was followed year in and year out, I've never seen that in my tenure as a legislator, and I will be voting no to this. Legislator Amo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm really impressed with Mr. Nagostakis. I didn't realize it convinced him. He's now convinced that inflation should be a factor when it comes to raises. I use that argument in committee on, for legislators. He told me that it wasn't correct. But my point really, I think, goes beyond what Mr. Nagostakis says. I think it's a populist position. You should treat everybody equal. I think what we should have the opportunity by the county executive to keep the strongest people we have in our county. We're in a region. We're in an employment region. We can be, our employees can move to other counties. They can move to New York City. We have to stay competitive. And if we have a very strong employee that's doing an incredibly good job for us with unusual skills, we should have the ability, at least through the cap, give him the reward for that.
Okay, Paul. You know, as it's been said already, we've discussed this at length. We discussed it last year, we discussed it again this year, last month. And, you know, throughout all discussion, we continue to hearing the term raises, giving people raises. We're not giving anybody raises. All we're doing is adjusting the cap. We have several managers who have been at the cap for quite a while now. This cap hasn't been adjusted, I believe, in over 10 years. The fact that we have to hire managers at the cap tells you that this adjustment is way overdue, should have been done a long time ago. We have managers making less than people that they're managing. Steve, I think you said too often we treat our managers like second-class citizens, and they're doing some of the most important work in the county. I think if we don't pass this is going to be a real insult to our management. And I think it should have been passed last month. It would have been passed last month. So to send this back to committee and to discuss it over and over again, I just think it's redundant. I think we need to move forward. Thank you.
Legislator Sullivan.
I just want to point out that there are possibly, I think, 6 or 7 positions that were hired at the cap within the last few years. That, to me, is not proof enough to show that we need to raise the cap. Just because someone is being hired at the cap doesn't tell me that it was needed to be at the cap. And you are not by treating everyone equally, we are being unfair. Just look at the discrepancy of the years of service on this list. You would never, ever not look at that when negotiating any other contract. Why would you do that now with these 50 people? Not only that, but these are 50 people who are at the cap. 50 out of, I believe the number was 150. In the next few years, you will be seeing the rest of those people eventually reach that cap. Are you going to keep throwing out 3% raises straight across the board, not taking anything into consideration, such as loyalty and service to the county? That, to me, is absolutely wrong, and that is why I'll be voting no today. And nobody, I also want to make the point that this has turned into a political football, and no one else has turned this into a political football but this legislature. And it is not fair to the people who we are supposedly serving.
Yes, Legislator Cheney.
A little different spin on this. To me, this is about providing to our current employees and rewarding them for their professional and capable service to the county, particularly for employees whose career objective is to lead and manage in the department where they have worked. Their institutional knowledge and close working relationship with their peers often makes them the best candidate for that management position. The hurdle comes when the employee has to face a pay cut in order to move to management when their current non-management salary is close to or sometimes above this cap. If we want government to work effectively and efficiently, we need the ability to put the best candidate in the position, and raising this cap will do this. I'm voting for this because I want to support our current employees who aspire to serve the county in greater ways.
Okay, roll call. Oh, I'm sorry.
So I had to relook at this much closer. I'm relatively new, and I'm going to vote a little differently than I took a close look at it and I did some investigation. The long and short of this thing is, when you talk about being unfair to employees, this is not a raise. However, if there are employees that deserve a raise, they cannot get it. Once again, it's up to the discretion as to who gets the raise and who doesn't. It's very possible that if we raise this cap, no one will get a raise. We're not talking about money here. We're talking about the availability to compensate the individuals that deserve raises. I know of one, I won't mention his name. He hasn't gotten a raise for, I think, 8 years. He's been out of the cap. He's probably one of the most, one of the best employees that we have. However, he cannot get a raise if we don't raise the cap. Once again, it's not a question of us giving out 3% or 5%. In private industry, this would just not happen. It just, in 10 years, it's ridiculous. So anyway, I'm going to vote that we raise the cap for that reason. So we can be fair to the employees we want to be fair to. You can't blanket this thing and just stop everybody. So, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis?
No.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
No.
Vanelli?
Yes.
Cantorino?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
No.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ekus?
No.
Fagione?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Chemnitz?
No.
Kulisek?
No.
Paduk?
No.
Ruskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
No.
Vero?
Yes.
Brescia?
Yes.
12 ayes, 9 noes. Motion passes.
Okay, the desk is cleared and we have one speaker, John, signed up. Try to keep it within 3 minutes, John. I know you went over 3 at the legal land public hearing. I know. We give you a little latitude when we only have one speaker, though. Okay. I'll give you 4 tops. I'm going to put out the cane.
It's just an observation. My sister, you're arguing about whether people get raised with a football. I don't know if you ever heard of it. There's such a thing as a wage and salary plan. You get job description. You evaluate the people. You compare them with jobs in the area or comparable jobs. And you put ceilings on the ranges on their salaries, and they stick in those ranges. If for some special reason, it's not that they deserve additional money, it's usually brought up at additional time. And that's usually, I mean, they say that's the way the big companies do it. I was in human resources all my life. And if I had, and I was in charge of human resources for McCormick and some others, some big companies.
You better get on Lego Land, because you're using up your Lego Land time. You're out of time.
Why should it count? You know, it's ironic. I've been trying for a long time to find out who's responsible for Lego Land. The county says it's town. The town says the county. I finally found out tonight it's the town. But I'm talking to you anyway. As you're probably aware, I have your shirt. And so I'm not in favor of Legoland moving to Goshen. I feel the request should be turned down and they should find a more receptive location. I realize they are open for the younger generation of handicapped. However, the efforts would be more effective in a more suitable and receptive location, for example, Newburgh, who has space for it, Windsor, in Connecticut. My opposition is outlined in the attached papers I gave you where I submitted 37 reasons why Legoland application should be rejected, and also my response to the recent mailing and the facts about Legoland. So I put a lot of thought into this. And gentlemen, Legoland is a scam. And they're going to be investing, they're not going to invest a nickel because they're borrowing all the money they're getting. And if they decide to go back up, belly up, they don't lose a nickel. The state, the county, and the federal government are going to take the beating. If at any time the legislature would like to discuss with me, I'd be only too happy to sit down and talk about my 37 pages. And 37 plus pages. I guarantee that if you went through this carefully and read those things, you'll find out it's a con game. And it makes Bernie Madoff look like an amateur. What more can I say?
Thank you, John. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Adjourned.
All in favor? Aye.